Welcome to Money for the Rest of Us. This is a personal finance show on money, how it works, how to invest it, and how to live without worrying about it. I'm your host, David Stein. Today is episode 474. It's titled, Are Emerging Markets Bonds a Once-in-a-Generation Opportunity? A month or so ago, one of our members of Money for the Rest of Us Plus sent me a strategy piece by the asset manager GMO. It was written by Victoria Cormier. She's on the portfolio management team for GMO's emerging markets debt funds. In the piece, she wrote, based on our reading of valuations for emerging markets debt, we anticipate looking back at this current period as a generationally attractive entry point for emerging market local debt. Now, in this episode, we're going to take a look at emerging markets debt, but there's a distinction that she made. There's emerging markets local debt, which is denominated in the local currency of the issuing country, and there is U.S. dollar-denominated emerging markets debt that the interest and principal needs to be paid in U.S. dollars. And as an investor, investing in emerging markets U.S. dollar-denominated debt, you don't have the currency risk. You're not hurt by the weakening of the emerging markets country's currency, nor do you benefit when emerging markets currencies appreciate relative to the U.S. dollar. Cormier continues, the U.S. dollar overvaluation is at relatively extreme levels, likely to provide a strong ongoing tailwind for non-dollar assets in general. We believe emerging market local debt can be a powerful way to capitalize on this as a supplement to both emerging markets equities and other asset classes. In another piece she wrote that was published in the Financial Times that I'll link to, GMO estimates that the U.S. dollar is 8 to 15% overvalued versus the currency baskets that make up emerging markets local debt and emerging markets equities. She concludes in her piece, we believe that for relative value, diversification, and potential alpha reasons, alpha being excess returns, emerging markets local debt deserves a prominent place in portfolios today. If you're like me, when you think of emerging markets debt, first word that comes to mind is default. Fitch, which is a rating agency, pointed out last year that there have been 15 separate default events for emerging markets bonds since 2020, and that's across 9 different countries. That compares to 19 defaults across 13 countries between the year 2000 and 2019. Because of the pandemic, as well as rising government indebtedness as a result to responding to the pandemic and just social programs and other government spending, that has led to continued defaults for emerging markets bonds. Fitch points out that currently there are 5 emerging markets countries in default on their debt: Belarus, Lebanon, Ghana, Sri Lanka, and Zambia. Some of the other defaulted countries, such as Argentina, have worked to restructure their debt. And oftentimes, when a country defaults, they'll work with the International Monetary Fund to get some funding and restructure that debt. And by and large, the type of debt that we're talking about, be it local currency debt or U.S. dollar denominated debt, this is debt issued by governments. The vast majority of emerging markets debt is sovereign debt rather than corporate debt. So it would appear then that emerging markets bonds is going through a challenging environment with these defaults. Yet, if we look at the returns for U.S. dollar-denominated emerging markets bonds ETFs and the performance of active fund managers in the emerging markets debt space, they have outperformed the U.S. bond market as measured by the Bloomberg U.S. Aggregate Bond Index. They've outperformed for the past year, 3 years, 5 years, and 10 years. Over the past decade, the iShares JP Morgan U.S. dollar emerging markets bond ETF has returned 2.4% annualized compared to 1.4% annualized for the Bloomberg U.S. Aggregate Bond Index. The DoubleLine Emerging Markets Fixed Income Fund has returned 3% annualized over the past decade, compared again to 1.4% for the Bloomberg U.S. Aggregate Bond Index. Those funds I mentioned are U.S. dollar-denominated emerging markets debt funds. The local currency version has not outperformed the bond market. For example, the iShares J.P. Morgan Emerging Markets Local Currency Bond ETF returned negative 1.7% annualized for the past decade ending April 8th, 2024. And so it did lag. The main reason it trailed was because emerging markets currencies have weakened over the past decade. There's been a negative 6.2% annualized drag for emerging markets Latin American currencies relative to the U.S. dollars. And for emerging Europe and Middle East, it's also been a 6% annualized drag. So that would have reduced the return by 6 percentage points per year just due to currencies, even though the yield on local currency emerging markets debt would have been much higher than developed markets bonds. Now, analysts at GMO and others believe that there's been a change to what's going on with emerging markets. Even though they have outperformed, they think they're going to do even better. Before we continue, let me share a word from our sponsors at Betterment. Do you want your money to dream big? Do you want your money to be a total self-starter? Are you annoyed that your money doesn't work hard enough? Don't worry. Betterment is here to help. Betterment is the automated investing and savings app that makes your money hustle. Their automated technology is built to help maximize returns, meaning when you invest with Betterment, your money can auto-adjust as you get closer to your goal. Rebalance if your portfolio gets too far out of line, and your dividends are automatically reinvested. That can increase the potential for compound returns. In other words, your money is breaking a sweat, while you can be breaking bread. You'll never picture your money the same way again. Betterment, the automated investing and savings app that makes your money hustle. Visit Betterment.com to get started. Investing involves risk. Performance is not guaranteed. Cormier writes that it's difficult to spot inflection points, particularly when we think about the nonstop dollar strength. Taking a position against the dollar right now to say that it will stop appreciating relative to other currencies. Not just taking that position when investing in local currency emerging markets debt, but just investing in non-U.S. stocks, for example, on an unhedged basis. That's somewhat contrarian, saying that, well, the U.S. dollar isn't going to continue to strengthen relative to the rest of the world. Cormier writes, the key question is, can the U.S. be even more exceptional than it is now to continue the dollar's upward trend? The glass half-empty Frenchwoman in me believes geopolitical risks, the Russian-Ukraine war, Middle East conflicts, China-Taiwan tensions, and a low-growth environment in most places outside the U.S. might signal that we have not yet reached such an inflection point. There are many reasons to stay invested in the U.S. and not venture out to other areas, either stocks or bonds. Cormier continues, in a world of risk aversion, the dollar can indeed remain king. The glass half-full American in me, she continues, sees factors such as sluggish growth and a lack of structural reforms in recent years already priced into non-U.S. currencies. In other words, investors are now more highly compensated for the risks associated with emerging market currencies than they have been for more than a decade. And that's the key. When it comes to investing, are we being compensated for the risk in terms of the potential return? Is the asset class cheap enough? Are the yields high enough on bonds to compensate for that risk? Are the dividend yields high enough and the valuations low enough, as reflected by price-to-earnings ratios, sufficient to compensate for risk on the equity side? That's one reason we launched Asset Cap, so that we can look at those factors. What's the compensation? Right now, Asset Cap is focused on stocks, and we just released a major update for Asset Cap with additional tools, additional charts to help answer these questions. And we're working on the bond side to add that to Asset Cap. But are we being compensated for the risk we're taking? I read another report by an analyst, Rusher Sharma. He was writing for the Financial Times, and he pointed out that there are some emerging world powerhouses, such as India and Indonesia. Do you realize, and I saw this on Asset Camp, looking at the 20-year annualized returns ranking the 46 stock indices that we cover, the best performing index over the past two decades was India, because the economy is growing fast and they've been more disciplined in terms of government finances. And Sharma points out that India and Indonesia are recognized that they're in solid shape and they've been successful in navigating the economic challenges, including the pandemic. But he sees that other countries are now reforming, including Turkey, Argentina, Egypt, Nigeria, and Kenya. Those five countries are large countries, make up, they're in the top 40 of emerging economies. And even though they've had high inflation and high debt deficits, the market is forcing them and politics are forcing them to be more disciplined. There have been new leadership brought in on some of those countries with the mandate to reform, to bring down the deficits, to bring down inflation, to bring down interest rates. Because when investors get spooked, money flows out of the country. But when things become more attractive and they see reform, capital flows in to those countries, and that can strengthen the currency relative to the U.S. dollar and other developed currencies. So I read a number of reports that suggest there are emerging market countries that are reforming, and the riskiest emerging market countries have actually seen the best performance of late. The incremental yield for relative to treasury bonds for sub-Saharan Africa emerging markets debt has gone from over 10% in May 2023 down to around just over 6% today. Valentina Chen, who is co-head of emerging markets at the investment firm Mackay Shields in London, says they're seeing great value in single B and triple C emerging markets debt credits, such as for Argentina, Egypt, and Kenya. The riskiest segment of the market, triple C, U.S. dollar-denominated emerging markets bonds have returned 16% year-to-date. That's something to consider, though, when we talk about emerging market bonds. By and large, these are non-investment grade. They are risky, and so you get higher yields with emerging market bonds. But you can also get currency weakness if things aren't going well. And that's what brought down the returns into negative territory over the past decade for emerging markets local currency debt. Now, what are those yields today as we look at the universe? If we look at emerging markets U.S. dollar bonds, an example would be the iShares J.P. Morgan U.S. dollar emerging markets bond ETF, ticker is EMB. And I'll make sure in the show notes we'll list out the ticker symbols and the names for any of the investments that we've mentioned today. But if we look at emerging markets U.S. dollar bonds, if data going back to 1996, this is data from Bloomberg, it's returned 7.3% annualized, the index. The average yield to maturity going back to 1996 has been 7.4%. The current spread or incremental yield for U.S. dollar emerging markets bonds is 3% right now. The long-term average has been 4%. Historically, when I have analyzed emerging markets bonds, I've been most comfortable investing when the spread is greater than average. It's not now. And so we talk about a generational opportunity. Cormier from GMO is focused on local currency emerging markets debt, but U.S. dollar denominated emerging markets debt, the spread is not wider than average. And just the average duration or interest rate sensitivity is around 6 years. So that's the U.S. dollar denominated debt. If we look at the emerging markets local currency bond ETF by iShares, ticker is LEMB. So we've mentioned the returns have been negative 1.6% annualized over the last decade, negative 2% annualized over the past 5 years, and negative 3.5% over the past 3 years. Its SEC yield, which would be its yield to maturity less fees, is just around 7%. This is where I found a discrepancy. We subscribe to Bloomberg fixed income data, and that's what we're using to build out the bond side of Asset Camp, and we also use the information on Money for the Rest of Us Plus. There's the Bloomberg Local Currency Emerging Markets Debt Index, is government debt. It says the yield to maturity on that is 4%. And yet, if we look at the iShares JP Morgan Emerging Market Local Currency Bond ETF, if I look at a similar ETF by State Street, they're showing yield to maturities of 7%. And yet this index is saying 4%. I have an email into our Bloomberg reps to sort of figure out what's going on here. What I believe is the issue is that China was added to the emerging markets debt local currency indexes back in 2020. And interest rates on Chinese government debt are fairly low. The 10-year yield on China government bonds is 2.3%. compared to something like Mexico, where the 10-year bond yield is 9.6%. So depending on how much is allocated to China in an emerging markets debt fund or an index, that will determine the yield. But it's odd to me that the yield to maturity, at least on the data that we're getting from Bloomberg, it's so much lower, and it has been, so there's something going on there. We're not investing in indexes. We're investing in ETFs. So the SEC yield of the iShares JP Morgan Emerging Market Local Currency Bond ETF is 7%. Now, if we look at the U.S. dollar denominated version versus the local currency version, there is some difference in composition. Credit quality for the U.S. dollar denominated version is actually lower at BB+. Where it's BBB for the local currency version. So EMB is BB+, the lower credit quality, essentially high yield, non-investment grade, where the local currency version is BBB. And the difference there is China again. The biggest holding in the local currency version is China at 15%, followed by Mexico at 7%, Indonesia at 7%. So more highly rated emerging markets countries. If we look at the local currency version, the top holding is Turkey at 4.3%, followed by Saudi Arabia at 4%, Brazil at 3.6%, Mexico at 3.4%. So the dollar-denominated version of these funds have obviously less currency risk, but more credit risk. Both these ETFs have over 600 bonds. Those are two examples based on just different credit qualities, comparing local currency versus U.S. dollar. Before we continue, let me pause and share some words from this week's sponsors. If you've been using Mint to manage your finances, then you know Mint shut down. Well, let me tell you about the solution I've been using for the past 4 months. It's Monarch Money. Monarch Money is the top-rated all-in-one personal finance app. It gives you a comprehensive view of all your accounts, investments, transactions, and more. You can create custom budgets, set goals, and collaborate with your partner. And now get an extended 30-day free trial when you go to monarchmoney.com/David. What I like about Monarch is the ability to customize what I see. I have a custom budget, and I really like their cash flow screen so I can see which budget categories I spent the most each month. I just did that yesterday. I especially like Monarch because they'll never sell your data to third parties or show you ads. After trying out Monarch for myself, I understand why it's the top-rated personal finance app. And right now, get an extended 30-day free trial when you go to monarchmoney.com/David. That's monarchmoney.com/David for your extended 30-day free trial. How do we invest then? Well, we can do ETFs like we've just mentioned, EMB and EMBL. We could invest in an active mutual funds. One of the points that GMO mentioned is that if looking at InvestNet data, that it shows that the median emerging markets debt active manager has outperformed a comparable ETFs and indexes. So there is a case, and I have generally invested in emerging markets through active funds. Although we did have EMB in our Money for the Rest of Us Plus model portfolios a number of years ago, but now emerging markets bond exposure is coming through DoubleLine in those model portfolio examples. So our choice is ETFs. We can do active mutual funds, but there's also closed-end funds that we can invest in. For example, in looking at what's available in the closed-end fund space, there's the Morgan Stanley Emerging Markets Debt Fund, MSD. Closed-end funds use leverage. They are more volatile than active mutual funds and ETFs because their price can disconnect from the net asset value, and that fund has a distribution rate of over 10%. The Morgan Stanley Emerging Markets Domestic Debt Fund, so this would be the local currency version, EDD, it's selling at a 14% discount to its net asset value, and its distribution rate is 7.7%. In the show notes of this episode, I'll link to a guide on investing in closed-end funds because they're unique, and we also have a course that you can get access to on closed-end funds through being a member of Money for the Rest of Us Plus, or you can buy the course directly, but check out the guide first. But we can invest via closed-end funds, and we can invest via active mutual funds. So the DoubleLine Emerging Markets Fixed Income Fund I've mentioned. There's the DoubleLine Low Duration Emerging Markets Fixed Income Fund. There's the Virtus Stone Harbor Emerging Markets Debt Fund. All those funds have had very similar 10-year returns. In fact, the active mutual funds and the ETFs have had similar 10-year returns. The Morgan Stanley Emerging Markets Debt Fund, it's done a little better at 3.5% annualized. It'd be the US dollar version. So those are the vehicles that we can invest in. We need to decide whether we want a local currency version or a US dollar denominated version. By going with the local currency version, you will benefit if the dollar weakens relative to emerging market currencies, or be hurt if it strengthens. We need to decide whether we want to go active or passive. And then we want to understand the characteristics of the fund. How much diversification is there? What is the credit quality? What's the expense ratio? If it's a closed-end fund, how much leverage is being used? All the things that we talk about in analyzing in investment vehicles. We look at my portfolio. About 7% of my bond portfolio is emerging markets bonds, and it's primarily coming through the DoubleLine Income Fund, DSL. So this is a closed-end fund. I held it from 2013 to 2018, but after two very strong years, it was up 30% in 2016, 16% in 2017. I sold it when its discount to net asset value narrowed, and I just saw investment conditions deteriorating slowly, and I just wasn't comfortable with the risk of the fund, so I sold it. But then I bought it back in December 2020. By then, it was selling at a 6% discount to its net asset value, and the fund is 40% emerging markets. Now, it's a closed-end fund, so it's risky. So in my holding period since December 2020, there's been a 34% maximum drawdown, but it's returned around 11% annualized since December 2020. And so that's where I'm getting exposure. But it's not a big position, so maybe I should consider increasing my allocation to emerging markets bonds. Is it really a once-in-a-generation opportunity? We're looking at yields of 6 to 7%, and part of me is, that's not real great when I can earn 5% on cash. I would really benefit, would want the boost from the strengthening currency, and I have other investments that benefit from that, mostly on the emerging markets equity side, and I'm very much overweight emerging markets relative to the global stock market. And there's a part of me that with emerging markets is sort of what is the next crisis coming along. And yet, here we have emerging markets bonds have actually outperformed the developed markets bond space. Investors have been adequately compensated with higher yields investing in emerging markets bonds. And if it could be done through an active manager that hopefully can get out or avoid some of the potential defaults, given there have been dozens of defaults over the past few decades. Yet even with that, they have done better. That's why I prefer active manager. I would prefer if the spreads were wider than average, but they're not. And maybe we won't ever go back to that except in a period of huge crisis. And when I added DoubleLine, the DoubleLine Income Solutions Fund in December 2020, we did have above average emerging markets bond spreads relative to government bonds. And that's why I added it then. That's not where we're at today. Yet we have analysts like those at GMO saying, well, because the dollar is so strong relative to emerging markets countries and the yields are still attractive at 7%, that combination of weak emerging market currencies but attractive yields makes for an attractive entry point. We'll see how it works out. But that's our discussion this week on investing in emerging markets bonds. That's episode 474. Thanks for listening. You may be missing some of the best Money for the Rest of Us content. Our weekly Insider's Guide email newsletter goes beyond what we cover in our podcast episodes and helps elevate your investment journey with information that works best in written and visual formats. With the Insider's Guide, you can discover actionable investing insights provided only to our newsletter subscribers. Unlock greater investing confidence with high-value snippets from our premium products, plus membership and asset camp. Access exclusive news, offers, and events you won't hear about anywhere else. Further connect with the Money for the Rest of Us team and community. And when you sign up, we'll also send you our exclusive investing checklist to help you invest with more confidence right away. The Insider's Guide is the best next step to get the most out of your investment journey. If you're not on the list, go to moneyfortherestofus.com and subscribe with the Become a Better Investor sign-up box. Everything I've shared with you in this episode has been for general education. I've not considered your specific risk situation. I've not provided investment advice. This is simply general education on money, investing in the economy. Have a great week.